Hi everybody, Colin from the Bike Dads. Today I'm looking at the Orbea Rise. This is the M limited edition. It's an $11,000 e-mountain bike. It has 140 millimeters of front suspension, 140 millimeters of rear suspension, and it's the bike that proves to me I won't be buying a normal bike again. So e-bikes have come a long way in the last few years. And you know, the only drawbacks you can really say right now are the fact of the weight, especially for the full power e-bikes, obviously, and maybe range anxiety with battery power. So if you stay with me, I'm gonna tell you why this bike completely eliminates all those things for me. Now, while this is the fancy pants version of this bike, and it comes with the Fox 34 and the inline shock, you can get this bike also with a 36 and a piggyback shock, which makes it more of a capable trail slash almost enduro type bike. But that only gives you an extra, you know, 4 or 5 pounds onto the build, if that. While this build comes in at around 36 pounds, I did put some Maxxis Minions XO Plus tires on it, as well as my favorite carbon bar, the 1UP bar, and it comes in just over 37 pounds, not too shabby. Now, there's no denying that full fat e-bikes still have a lot of heft to them. Usually they're about 50 pounds plus, and it takes a lot of rider input and a skilled rider to maneuver those bikes well. Now, when you introduce something like this, a bike that weighs maybe 5 pounds more than a normal bike, a non-motorized bike, this changes the game. I would bet if the battery wasn't in the down tube, but you left the motor in there, it would feel as good as a non-motorized bike, maybe even better because of where that weight is, like I mentioned. The motor is the Shimano EP8 with Orbea's own take on it. So what they've done is reduced the power down to 60 newton meters of torque from 80 newton meters and have adjusted the firmware to give it their ideal ride quality. And with the 360 watt hour battery, that'll give you a lot of range. And those that are planning big rides, you can fit a range extender on there, which is equivalent to 70% of the main battery, and it fits in the water bottle holder, which tucks inside the frame. What this equates to is that with their firmware, the battery in the down tube, as well as the range extender, you're gonna have quite the days out on the bike. You'll be able to do a lot of elevation. Now, there's two settings to the Rise that come stock with Orbea's default settings. And one is a little more gusto, I would say, off the top. So you're gonna have a little more power deliver earlier and quicker in setting number two. And you know what, with the weight of the bike, this is plenty in a lot of circumstances. You're doing almost as well as a full fat, but not quite there. The thing about this bike is that if you go on to the forums, the Orbea Rise dark web, you will see what guys are doing with this bike already. So there's third-party software out there right now where you can actually take that tune right out of the equation. You can get the full 80 newton meters of torque, and what I've read so far, basically in a drag race with a full fat because of the weight of this bike, this thing burns everything. Of course, you're gonna negate your warranty if you do something like that, but you know what? This is proof of what's coming and what you can do right now. I just like Orbea to allow you to do this right out of the start, maybe by an app setting or something like that. Maybe it's something to do with the battery. If you're an electrical guy and you know something more than me, if the battery would limit delivering the full 80 newton meters of torque to the motor for some reason, drop a comment below. If it was me, I'm de-restricting back to 80 newton meters of torque right away because I like the full fat power experience. It is fun. You can go 32 kilometers uphill. You can better regulate your heart rate with more power in some circumstances. Now, there is that noise, I'm sure you've heard about it, associated with the EP8 motor. I don't care about it. It didn't bother me one bit. If it is a concern, I'm sure Shimano has a bunch of engineers trying to figure out how to reduce that. And on the next iterations, it won't be there. Another nice thing about this EP8 motor is the drag, or the lack of drag, I should say, once the motor cuts out at 32 kilometers an hour. On my full fat e-bikes I have, and I've had in the past, as soon as you hit that 32 kilometer mark, you really gotta pedal to get through any of the resistance that motor's getting you. So it's really hard to keep going. It's actually a reason why I wanna de-restrict my full fat e-bike is the fact I wanna keep going after 32 kilometers an hour when I'm going downhill. So the geometry of this bike is to my liking. This is a size medium. It has a 450 millimeter reach, which is perfect for me. It has a 66 degree head angle with this 140 fork, and it has about 445 millimeter stays. Now, that's pretty much perfect for me. I like the 440-ish range, but 5 mils on either side, fine with me. The seat tube angle is about 77 degrees, so it's a perfect position when you're seated and climbing. Now, you can manipulate this bike. If you go onto the dark web and look up Orbea Rise on the forums and what guys are doing with this bike, they're creating 160 millimeter rear travel and dural weapons with a 160 fork on. They're creating mullets, so they're putting a 27.5-inch wheel on the back using offset bushings to adjust the bottom bracket. The world is your oyster with this frame. They're getting the head angle down to about 64.5 degrees. It's amazing. So this build, like I said, is the fancy pants build, and everything was exceptional. From the XTR drivetrain to the Fox 34, it was an amazingly stiff fork for a 34-inch sanctioned fork. The dampening's amazing. It has fantastic brakes, XTR again, 2 pots. I'd probably go up to 4 pots if I was creating a more enduro style bike. It has the next wheel set from Race Face on it, so a super lightweight carbon hooped wheel set. And this particular bike came with 165 millimeter carbon cranks from E13. And that's the one gripe here. Those cranks come off, they've been known to come off. They came off to me when I rode, despite having blue Loctite on the top cap. I think what Orbea has done is just ditched those, because when I looked at the spec on the website, they're actually speccing Shimano Holotex now, which is probably the better choice, because you don't want your cranks to come off midair. You even get this carbon railed Italian seat, because it's super light, and that's what they were going for here. So overall, you get a very lightweight build, top quality build. And when you consider it's also an e-bike compared to some else, these, you know, Yetis and Santa Cruz non-motorized bikes, this actually comes off pretty good for price. As far as the lack of display for readings on the bike, I didn't miss it one bit. This just felt like riding a regular mountain bike. I wasn't paying attention to how much battery I had left, nor do I really care, to be honest, because at 37 pounds, if the battery runs out, I'll just pedal it. I've been riding this bike for the past 2 months, and I can honestly say this bike has been probably the funnest bike I've ever ridden. With the motor, you can ride endlessly far. You can tailor the way you ride, and the bike rides like a normal bike. It is phenomenal how good the ride quality is. The detriments of those heavier feeling e-bikes isn't there with this bike. And like I said, with that motor low down, you get so much grip that I almost like it better in most circumstances. It's so comfortable to jump and pop and change direction on the trail that I didn't even notice I was riding an e-bike. And it's quiet. With the exception of that motor, the rest of the bike is extremely quiet. And I take that little motor rattling anytime over, you know, a loud motor when I'm climbing. When you climb on this motor, you can't hear anything. Although the bike's not marketed with all those things guys are doing on the internet with their Orbea Rises, this bike can do it. And in my mind, that means it's possible now. Everyone else should be gearing up towards this style of bike. And you know what? They should be offering what customers want, what the guys are doing on the internet. That is what I want out of the box. If I purchased this bike, I'd probably do it. Who cares about the warranty? You only live once. I want that bike. As far as I'm concerned, the only thing they might be able to do better is make the battery removable. If you could remove that battery, maybe plug it with something, I would ride that bike in the bike park. It would take away the need for a regular pedal bike for me. Also, I think bike companies should take into, you know, consideration, not everyone's looking for a massive range on an e-bike. Perhaps they do well with having multiple batteries because they primarily shuttle and just lap, you know, around their local trail system. Sure, maybe I put on 203 millimeter rotors on it eventually if that's what I was doing, but these are all small changes. I think the bike is absolutely fantastic. I can't believe that it exists right now, and I think everyone else has to catch up when they're thinking about how they're going to build e-bikes. So come check out our website, www.thebikedads.com. We primarily focus on kids' mountain bike stuff, but we also talk about our own stuff once in a while and stuff of interest. So see you on the trails.